So for those who is the new to this the webinar, we are organizing this webinar jointly with the Global ADI Foundation. And ADB has been the secretariat of the Asian Bond Markets Initiative. And we are organizing the ASEAN Plus 3 Bond Market Forum. So basically, the participants of this webinar is the members and observers of the ABMF, but it's not limited to the those who regularly come to ABMF. We are extending the invitation to non-ABMF members. By the way, ASEAN Plus 3 Bond Market Forum is quite open forum. We are inviting the public sector and private sector experts who are interested in the market developments. So if you are interested in the ADI, please feel free to send us an email, and we are happy to share also those information. We still have a few more minutes, but let me start sharing what we have discussed in the previous webinars. So the first webinar, we started the starting from the introduction of ADI. So the Global ADI Foundation, which is sort of the governing body, sort of I mean, the operational governing body explained the structure of ADI. On the top, there is a forum, the committee called the Regulatory Oversight Committee, consisted of the regulators and public authorities. That is the ultimate governing body. But in operations, the Global ADI Foundation provides the various operational sort of governance. And local operating unit, they are the ADI issuer. And then the financial institution can support customers to get the ADI. And also, we in the second webinar, we learned the cases in United States. One notable example is the US Customs. U.S. Customs is currently considering the introduction of globally accepted identifier, and ADI is one. So once they decided, all the imports to United States must carry ADI. And J.P. Morgan shared their thoughts related to ADI and how ADI can create the benefits to the financial institutions for data management and improving their operational efficiency. The third webinar, we had speakers from Europe. So the European regulators are pushing the ADI to standardize the regulatory reporting format. And also, we learned kind of actual ADI implementation outside of the financial area, which is the authentication of entity to prevent fraudulent transaction by CETA. Then the India explained their implementation. Actually, the RBI, Reserve Bank of India, took kind of a very much strategic step to expand the use of ADI, starting from globally mandated OTC derivative reporting to lending, starting from the large entity, large firm with lending or financial activities. And now they mandate the implementation of ADI for the large payment, large value payment. And they will expand more. So that's the Indians' approach. And of course, the LOU support the implementation of the various entities in India. China is also taking quite systematic approach among financial regulators. So not just the People's Bank of China, PBOC, but also the securities regulator, bank and insurance regulator, also the foreign exchange management. They create the roadmap, and in the financial transactions, they also implement LEI. Currently, the mandatory reporting is one, but the recommended, also the voluntary implementation will be expanded, and hopefully, we see more sort of application. So now, United States, India, China, for various cross-border transactions, we see the implementation of LEI. And we expect more to come. So today's webinar, we will discuss the LEI or possible LEI implementation or application in the trade area. So we have two speakers, Mr. Oswald Kulila, the Managing Director of DSI International Chamber of Commerce, and Hans Huber, Senior PO Trade Finance Innovation and R&D, Commerzbank Germany. They will explain their perspective. And as usual, after those two presentations, we will have a Q&A session. So let me pass the floor to Oswald to start his presentation. So floor is yours.
Thank you so much. It's an absolute privilege to be with all of you today and to talk about LEI, and specifically LEI in a business context, if you will. Like mentioned before, my name is Oswald Kayla. I work at the International Chamber of Commerce. I'm based out of Singapore, and I'm running a project called the Digital Standards Initiative. And the core focus of this project is to see how do we accelerate the adoption of digital over paper globally for our trade and supply chain processes? I call it accelerate because we know that we will not be living in a paper-based world forever. We know that at some point we will transition to digital, and our big job is to see how do we accelerate that. I'm also quite privileged to be joined by Hans Huber, who's also going to be speaking to you today from Commerzbank. And just for you, those who don't know, the origins of the Digital Standards Initiative is actually from the business community saying, look, there's a challenge at help. And Hans was actually one of the key members, a part of that process to actually get this project up and running. So, as you're thinking through the conversations Hans and I are having, I think it's also good to get a sense of how those two operate together. If we can go to the next slide, what I'll do is I'll start the presentation now. What we're going to do today is we're going to touch on an overview of the DSI roadmap and how the LEI itself can play a role in facilitating interoperability across trade platforms. And to answer that question, what I'll do is I'll share really three key things. The very first one is what I'll do is I'll share with you a little bit the journey that we've gone on from the Digital Standards Initiative to get a sense of what is it that needs to be done for us to digitize supply chain and trade. And I'll talk a bit about how the LEI fits in that. The second one is I'm going to give you a little bit of a high-level view of just where the LEI itself can be applicable, especially when it comes to exporters and importers. And the final one, and I think this is also quite important, the final piece of information that I'll share with you today is why we think 2021 is actually the year where we should be focused on these topics. A lot of people will say, but Oswald, we've been talking about trade digitization now for 22 years. Why 2021? And I want to frame to you at least why we at the ICC believe that investing now is definitely something that you'll get a return on and is quite important. So if we go on to the next slide, I apologize up front. It is quite a busy slide. So what I'll do is I'm not going to talk through everything on the slide, but what I will do is give you some context first. When we started the project of, again, how do we accelerate trade digitization globally, we found ourselves in a very interesting world. 22 years ago, we saw the first commercial electronic bill of lading solution being delivered to the world. And about 15 years ago, we saw a second one coming in. And about 5-6 years ago, we saw the explosion of creativity and innovation with blockchain and DLT and a whole heap of other new platforms that came into existence. And while we've been on this journey from only one company producing value to two companies to a wealth of over 60 companies today, what we also saw was after all of that investment and time that we've also still only hit the digitization point of trade documentation, specifically the issuance of electronic versions of bills of lading at 0.1%. People will argue with me and say, isn't it 1%? Isn't it 0.5%? The reality is it's not necessarily good enough for what we're trying to achieve. And so what we did was we spent our first 3 months talking with people like Hans and other industries and over about 100 companies across the globe in multiple different industries to get a sense of, well, why are we not seeing digitization of supply and trade processes at scale? What's holding them back? And the reality is they realize it's because there's not just one problem to solve. It's not just a technological problem. There's quite a few different things that need solving for. And what you'll see on the slide on the left-hand side is you'll see that we identified 5 key areas. The very first one was we realized that a lot of people weren't actually using standards. So when we had the conversations with fintechs or when we went to importers and exporters and we said, hey, what are you actually using for that legal identification field in your customer relationship management system or your supplier relationship management system or in the fintech in the field where they actually have the customer or the consignee, et cetera, fielded into the solution. And we asked them that question. Most of them said, oh, you know, it was what the IT department came up with. That's fundamentally how their data points were created. And we realized there was a big opportunity for us to actually educate people and show them and create visibility that standards like the LEI and organizations like GLIFE exist, where you can actually go and you don't have to spend another 2-3 years defining new standards. Right now, today, you can go update your customer relationship management system, your supplier relationship management system, et cetera, with these standards. And the benefit is the more people who do it, the more interoperable we would become. Because again, if I'm using the same mechanism of approaching legal entity identification and my suppliers are doing the same thing and my customers are doing the same thing, I spend a lot less time translating when I move between different systems. So that was the first thing. We realized we needed to improve that finding standards is hard. And people recognize that standards are valuable. They recognize standards are all about sharing what good looks like. They recognize that it has an efficiency impact. It has an effectiveness impact. Efficiency, you don't have to spend 12 months figuring out how to define these things. Effectiveness, you can now digitize even more parts of your supply chain and trade processes because everyone's talking the same language. So a key objective of ours. The second and third one I won't talk too much about in today's LEI session, but it's the recognition that for us to digitize trade, it's not just a technology challenge, it's not just an operating model business challenge, it's also a legal and regulatory challenge. It's making sure that all of us together advocate for model laws like UNCTRAL's model law for electronic transferable records, that actually enables us to go from the physical pieces of paper to electronic versions legally so that if that carrier wants to discharge cargo, they can do so. And so that again is quite an important part. And again, these are not things that technology companies themselves can do. And this is why with the help of the Asia Development Bank, we've been able to create the Digital Standards Initiative and we've been able to work together to see how do we advocate for the adoption of that. The last two that I'll mention on this slide is just the standards themselves. So So yes, we have great standards like the LEI standard that we want more people to adopt. But at the same time, if you go back 12 months, there was no published standard for electronic bills of lading as an example. And so one of the core things that we had to do was firstly be mature enough to say, one organization is not going to own the whole world standard for digitizing trade and supply chains. And we had to find like-minded partners like BIMCO, FIATA, SWIFT, DCSA, et cetera, to say, how do we ensure that we can create digital standards for how do we produce this content digitally and ensure that we meet the members, the companies where they are at the actual organizations that they are currently using for standards on safety and all of these events. Now, again, what good are all of these production standards, how to produce all of this information, if the foundational elements between a warehouse receipt, a bill of lading, a purchase order, a purchase requisition, an invoice, if they are all using different ways of describing legal entities, the amount of translation required will kill the benefits associated with digitization pretty quickly when you have complex supply chains. So making sure that we have the appropriate people creating the standards, but at the same time, making sure that we're not blind to the data elements required within each of those standards. And that's why we're quite proud of being an advocate for GLIFE and LEI, not because there's any incentive for us to be that at the ICC, it's just because it is the solution that works. And sometimes that is exactly what you need. The last one is costly technology integration. The only thing I'll highlight there is, so you can tell, you can go and say, how do I empower the business community to create all of this information that they are creating? How do I empower the banks that support the business community so that they can actually use that through things like EUCP practically? But then at the same time, what's the glue? How do we share all of this information between different technology companies or different importers, exporters, carriers, et cetera? And this is where we're working with both ITFA on their DNI specification, with IMD on the trade trust specification. There's all these frameworks out there that's starting to evolve that can actually help people digitize documents in a sustainable way if they choose to do so. So if we go on to the next slide, what I want to do here is talk a little bit about that at a practical level. So when you think about any business, for that matter, you'll see the center point is really the company itself and what the company is trying to achieve. So it has its business strategy, it's ensuring that it allocates most of its capacity there, and it's trying to ensure that it competes at a margin level. So it's spending as little as it humanly can to achieve the objectives that it's trying to achieve. That's how they survive, making sure that the margin is there. And as a part of that, most companies have people all around them. On the left-hand side, they'll have suppliers, people who, you know, feed into them, and they have their customers, the actual people where the revenue is being generated. And in most industries, what you'll see is no single company is powerful enough or big enough to go and tell all of their suppliers or all of their customers to use their model for how to define legal entities, right? Because if every single customer or every single entity goes and does that with their suppliers, you'll end up just with a complete fragmentation and just complexity that people can't deal with. And so when you think about how they engage the suppliers and the customers, there's also different systems internally before we even get to the fintechs. So internally, you'll see customer relationship management systems, you'll see supplier relationship management systems, you'll see warehouse and inventory management systems. And in all of these systems, you'll see the processes that help fuel and drive that to value. And what will you see in each of those processes? You'll see the actors involved. You'll see the legal entities that are actually being driven. Now, you have a few options. Do you go and every single system has its own way of defining who those people are? Or do you use a standard that's already out there where you can actually trust it and it takes away some of the complexity from your own organization to view and verify? Not all, but a few of the steps. And what is the benefit if you then go and say, okay, well, if I follow a global standard, I can now tell my suppliers, I can tell my customers, look, I'm using the same global standard that the G7 and the G20 came out and said, this is the standard that we're pushing. And it enables me to integrate with my suppliers and customers at a way more effective and efficient rate. It's always easier having a conversation around integration when there's some form of standard that you can connect to and say, this is what I'm using, this is the benefit. The final thing I will mention on this slide is, as we go through this process, one of the key things that are also close and near and dear to my heart is not just the systems that fuel the way companies work and their ability to ensure that we actually know who we're talking about, but it's also the quality of our data. We can see that we're in this new age of analytics, automation, AI, robotics, et cetera. One of the key things that we need to have as a society to enable a lot of those business cases that the technologists are starting to open up for us is quality, reliable, verifiable data. And if you go into any company and you ask the analytics or reporting teams, what do you spend at least 30% of your time on? It is cleaning data, it's verifying data, it's trying to figure out the supplier that's registered in this way as a legal entity like this, in this system, is it the same person as the supplier that's registered in another system in another way? And you end up with these very expensive data scientists trying to do the translation, and it's a lot of value that even internally is being leaked. And so I want to leave you with that. This is not, AI is not just from my perspective important for us to digitize processes beyond a company's border and do that in an efficient and an effective way. It's also about how do we help the internal organization get access to reliable, verifiable data that it can use to both create better outcomes from a predictive analytics perspective, to help create those reports that management always needs. Have a lot of you who work for big companies, when you have to do your annual or your quarterly reporting, you'll realize that it's not just something that takes a day. Sometimes it takes up to a month. Again, that internal process, how do we ensure that the data there is actually solved for? So if we go on to the next slide, what I want to do is talk a little bit about why today, like why this conversation now? It's been 22 years. Why should we invest now? Shouldn't we wait? Well, there's a few things I'll say. The very first one is we live in quite a different world today than we did before the pandemic. And one of the key things I'll highlight, let's use Lazada. A lot of you in Asia will be familiar with Lazada, an online platform where merchants can sell their deals. Let's use two data points. One of the largest EBL solution providers out there that publishes their data has, I think, in total 60,000 people using it online to enable trade digitization. Lazada, in 1 year alone, signed up 70,000 new merchants onto their platform to sell their goods. Business is not against technology. If the value is there, if it's simple enough to use, you generally see uptake in that. And so when I look at that uptake in tech utilization, I think beyond just trade digitization, and I look at businesses moving to apps so that they can deliver food to people's homes. I look at people going to merchants to deliver their goods. You now have a whole group of people who prior to the pandemic didn't necessarily use technology as a part of their core business because it was a physical presence. People had to go physically to the shop and buy the good or buy the food. We've seen an evolution of that. And I think that's important from a change management perspective. If we want to digitize and we have an audience of people who are starting to use technology more, demystify it, this helps us. And with great puzzle pieces like the LEI, it actually helps ensure that we reduce the regret costs that people will go through as they embrace that. We're united in solving these challenges. If you go back 12 months, different consortia or different fintechs were trying to solve this. Through leadership like what Hunt and them have done, you now see Unitrol, ICC, WTO, all of us working together, ADB, to actually try and solve this collectively. How do we digitize trade and supply chain processes, which is just fantastic. And the last one on this, which is a little bit ironic, is paper doesn't translate quite well when it comes to reporting. So for we know that if you want to report on your trade processes or your supply chain processes and report on your ESG objectives, adding paper to that to record all of that is not going to work. So that is something that we need to solve for. And the final 2 points before I hand over to Hans, because I still have like 2 minutes left, but the final 2 points I would highlight is the benefits are still there. We know that we need to close the trade finance gap. We know that LEI can help a lot of these small companies who are now going into these new modern solutions to get access to financing, not get stuck in each solution. If we actually use elements like LEI to ensure that there's data interoperability between them. And it's not just for businesses, for governments too. If we digitize processes, we can actually help close that VAT gap that we're all too familiar with. And again, none of this is possible if you're not talking the same language when it comes to legal entities. We can be as smart as we want to be. That's foundational. So thank you so much. I have one more slide that just shows the website. It's going to go through some evolutions over the next month, Hans. But what you'll find there is you'll find all the standards there. You'll see LEI is there. We have identity management guide that's also on the website. And again, as the ITC, you'll see us advocating for LEI because we know that it removes a lot of friction for businesses. We know what the potential is, and we really want to help the world accelerate going from paper to digital. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Oswald. So I'd like to pass the floor to Hans.
Well, thank you very much, Oswald, for that vision of paperless trade, of ending paper for good in trade, and for all the benefits that you underscored this will have. But if we end the era of paper as the documentation carrier in trade, what is going to follow? It's going to be electronic records that will replace the paper. And if we replace paper by electronic records, we do need to find new ways of signing. If it's not wet ink, what will it be? How do we authorize and authenticate the digital interactions that that will replace paper? And there, you said that standards are important, and I think if we have standards for authorizing and authenticating in the digital exchange in trade that hopefully will be built, if we have that standards, then it'll be a lot easier, and all the benefits that you, Oswald, highlighted, making regulatory assertions easier, make fraud scams a lot harder, all these things will become a lot easier if we use standards, if we talk the same language. And for identities, for digital identities, this could become the verifiable lie. And the verifiable lie is the one component of the verifiable lie is the lie itself. So a digital identity will help us to say who I am in trade, and at the same time assert what I'm entitled to do. Please go to the next page, Tomo. Let's have a look at the architecture of a digital identity at all. I think it makes sense to distinguish between the term identifier and identity. The identifier tells you who, or tells anyone that you are dealing with, who am I? And there is one identifier that has been established ever since 2014, which is the legal entity identifier that Clive has developed. And to that identifier, I can add credentials. And if these credentials are verifiable, thanks to the architecture they've been built in, I have then a verifiable credential. A credential could be an assertion that I have undergone a certain education, or the assertion that I am entitled to act on behalf of Commerzbank in trade finance business up to an amount of, let's say, €1 million. And these credentials are being added to my identifier, and this will form an identity. In this way, if we produce a digital identity in that way, in a standardized manner, then I can use it to authenticate in digital exchange and to authorize my dealings. Please go one slide further. Right, and this will form a verifiable legal entity identifier. So in this diagram, you could see how that looks like. My employer, Commerzbank, could become an issuer of a verifiable legal entity identifier, so an issuer of a digital identity, and we could issue that to our customers, of which we have many. And many banks have a lot of customers. So if other banks were to join in and would also become a verifiable legal entity identifier issuer, then soon all the customers of banks who do trade would be in possession of a digital identity and could use this digital identity to authorize and authenticate against software processes that are being built between the companies in trade. And this will help effectively to end the requirement to exchange paper that is being signed using wet ink. So the verifiable legal entity identifier is one very important infrastructure in order to enable people to exchange purely digital. Let's go one step further, please. Next slide. Let me give you an example of how this world could look like in the future. In a letter of credit or in a trade relation, often risk mitigations in the form of letters of credits are being used. And these letters of credits may be orchestrated on networks that are being built between the single participants. One example is Contour. There could be other examples like DLT Ledgers or Trames or the established software providers like SureComp or SAP will build systems that are being positioned between the participants. This could be a blockchain-based system. It could be built on conventional means. However, we will have a lot of these networks in the space between the participants in trade, and the interactions that people will do on these systems will be underpinned by digital identities. Every step you take and in these networks and the access you're being granted in a on a transaction level will be facilitated by digital identities. And the verifiable lie is one standard that is already very prominent in trade and should be supported and built up in order to make this world that Ozzy has been dreaming of and that I'm also dreaming of a reality soon. Please go one step further. So I try to give you four examples of where identities play a role. And this is an identity or an organization can have an identity. That would be, in my case, my employer, Commerzbank, who has a legal entity identifier and delegates the credentials that the organization is being given by others in the course of digital interactions. They can delegate this to a person that is affiliated with Commerzbank. In this case, that would be myself. I would be a delegation target for a certain right that I'm being given, and that is registered against Commerzbank as a verifiable credential in against their legal entity identifier. And I would then be put in a position to, for instance, make or check things in a letter of credit transaction. And in the future, we could even automate that. In this case, a software process would have a digital identity, and we could automate, for instance, responses to letter of credit applications. And the last holder of an identity could be a thing. That may be a sensor built into a container to monitor the imposed transport corridor conditions like humidity, temperature, chi forces, anything. Here in this world that we're building now, digital identity is the is one of the most important building blocks, and having standards for it will make it a lot easier to build this world. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Hans. So let me open the floor for a Q&A. And I think the first it's kind of a comment and also probably the question. The first one is the sort of a digital identity and a digital certificate. And those two is going to be quite important. I think it just very much related just to Hans also explained. And also there is another standard, a beneficiary ownership data standard, or the other one, OCDS. I think this is the open contracting data standard. Yeah. Yeah, well, I guess the LEI is one of the solution to address partial identification, and there is a room to expand. But how we should consider the kind of relationship with other digital certificate or other standard, and how we can increase the usability of digital identity, maybe starting from Oswald. Do you have any comment on that?
I do, and I really appreciate that question, because it's a really good question that hits to the core of the conversation when it comes to identity. So I'll take both of them separate, and then I'll introduce a third one just to add some more complexity to the question. So when we think about the BODS, and for those of you who don't know, it's the Beneficiary Ownership Data Standard. You'll see, for example, as a part of that standard, you'll see that they have, for example, interested party and their schema, where you can actually register the interested party. And if you go into the schema and you have a look at, well, what's required, what is the actual definition of interested schema, you'll see that it, for example, just highlights, you know, string. Which is fundamentally a mechanism in which you can enter, you know, text. And very similar when I look at the OCDS standard and its building blocks, it has a very similar, and I'm using these as references because I have them in my books on my phone. And you have a look at the definition and building blocks for parties. Again, it says, yes, you have to have parties as a part of the building block. But in my view, at least, this is where LEI is quite compatible with these different schemas, because fundamentally what you want to do is say, yes, I want to use these big schemas so that I can actually define the actual parties themselves, the addresses, and all of the things required for me to actually have my suppliers registered in the appropriate way or whatever it might be. But instead of just having the technologist allocate a string field to that, potentially leverage like what Hans highlighted, the actual LEI code, because fundamentally that helps me to both enter the data in the string field and achieve that objective, but also make sure that that data is verifiable externally, which is also quite beneficial. The third one I'll add, and it's a bigger conversation around multiple data standards, is we get a similar question around TIN or the Swift BIC code or governments having different approaches when it comes to the LEI standard. And this is where I'll offer two views. The first one is, if you have a look at what Glyph and Swift has done with BIC, there's actually a translation, a mechanism for you to translate between those two. So that based on the process that you're executing, you can select the appropriate one. There are quite a few processes where companies probably don't want to use a BIC code as the identifier, where they need the LEI, but there's a lot of value in actually being able to map these two together. The second thing that I'll add there is, we will live in a world where there are multiple identity standards, or identity for goods, identity for legal entities, identity for people, identity for banks and branches, etc. And this is where, again, complementary. So I see LEI, BODS, OCDS, I see them all complementary to each other when you leverage frameworks like the W3C's DID specification. And what that specification does is it enables companies, countries, governments to say, you know what, I'm going to use a protocol for identity. So the protocol, for example, would be DID. So you can go DID dot LEI and the LEI code, or DID dot BIC and the BIC code. Because what we'll end up with is a world where there's multiple different providers, at least in my view, for different use cases. And you'll be able to use that protocol to resolve it. But in my view, at least, when it comes to internal systems and it comes to OCDC, it comes to BODS, in these situations where it just goes, well, you have to have a string and you can define what that string looks like, this is exactly where you want to supplement that with LEI. I can spend another hour on that, but I'm pretty sure that that would not be appropriate, but it's a great question.
Yeah, Oswald, thanks. Hans, do you want to add more?
Well, it's all correct what Oswald says. There's a lot of use in standardization. I'm sorry, I'm just reading through another question that I was posed. Matthias Schmidt is asking if German business registers issue certificates of origin or residence in electronic form using or embedding LEI or VLEI. This is a very interesting question, since electronic issues of or certificates of origins are in the process of being developed by the Industrie- und Handelskammern in Germany, as I have been informed. And I'm pretty sure that the LEI will play a role there, and or is already playing a role there. And I'm not aware of the verifiable LEI already being used there. However, it is a very good question in the direction of expanding the use of the legal entity identifier, not only for digital negotiable instruments like the bill of ladings and warehouse receipts, but also to all other trade documentations, like also an invoice or a purchase order or a certificate of origin or bill of materials. And this gives a bit of an understanding of how broad this field is and how useful standardization and how imperative standardization is in that field. And I have no clear information about the VLEI being on the radar of the industry chambers in Germany, but I will investigate in the next weeks.
I would add one more thing to that question, and I can't agree more with what Hans said. One additional thing that went a little bit under the radar in the last 2 to 3 weeks, which I also think is important for us all to recognize, is you would have seen that the G7 ministerial group made an announcement around adopting or focusing on the adoption of the UNCITRAL model law for electronic transferable records. And you would have seen that quite in the press quite a bit. What people didn't necessarily see is that they've made a commitment to quite a few different elements, not just MLETR, but that was the one that got a lot of attention. In the same declaration, the second or the third item that they agreed to work on was actually digital standards. And for us all to work together on what are the standards, how do we actually enable? It's great having a model law for electronic transferable records, but if we're all talking a different language, we know that the complexity associated with that is actually going to impact the change and the adoption required for us to actually move to digital. And that's why you'll see, I think it is the second priority was actually digital standards. And this is, you can't talk about digitization standards without talking about the LEI, in my view at least.
Okay, thanks. Well, let me move on to the second question. That is the UK's initiative to move to the further digitization of the legislation and the regulation, and whether that would create an impact you have any thoughts on this as well, maybe?
I do, but I fear I might not be answering the question directly in the way that I might be answering it. So if I don't, please do say it in the chat and go, Ozzy didn't answer it. we can try again. So I have two answers to that. The very first one is I think the UK did a phenomenal job when it comes to both making the case, the business case for why we need to go digital. And that came from the business community. The business community with ICC worked on what is the value of actually digitizing, and then working with government to say, what can the business community itself do and what can government do? And sometimes people go and say, okay, well, the only thing government can really do is legislation, regulation, and customs. Like there's a view that that's kind of the core areas that government operate in. And it's very important. We need to advocate for them in those spaces to make the changes. But there's another key area where governments can actually play a big part. And I think the UK is a good example. I think other nations like Singapore, Thailand, and a few others are also good examples where a government realizes that by it digitizing its own processes with its own community, with its own citizenship, it actually helps do two things. One is it actually helps that local community get familiar with digitization, get used to using digitization. So a government that digitizes its own processes, in effect, is helping its own citizens embrace digitization. So when businesses come around and say, I'm going to offer you now trade finance in a completely different way because we've now finally solved the KYC in a different way or KYS in a different way, the citizens are already digitally native. And I think that's something that governments are uniquely powerful at creating, is actually making sure that the community can do it. The second thing that the government does in that same space is de-risk it. Because fundamentally, if you've been doing business all your life using a certain way of operating, and now someone's coming with this magical solution and this new LEI, and life is just going to be great, you're skeptical. But if the government, again, is playing a leading part in that digitization journey by adopting model laws that enables you to go electronic, by offering their services in an electronic way, you're way more likely to then go and say, okay, well, I'm then actually going to make the move too. And so that's kind of how I would answer it. I think the UK is doing a fantastic job. We need to make the case for change. There's a business case there that's quite impressive for every single country. I really believe it. And there's a place that government can help both with regulation, but also in preparing its citizenship and embracing digital. Thanks. I hope that answered it.
let me add to this because I really like what Oswald just said. However, it is on us to ask our governments to propel digitization By saying on us, I mean people who make business. We need to support bodies like the ICC in lobbying the governments to take steps take the right steps into digitalization and make necessary legal changes and policy changes. And the more we, the people who do trade and do business, ask our governments to do this, the easier it may become, or the faster it may be. We are currently lobbying onto the German legislator to make some necessary changes, some minor changes to make our commercial code fully NLETR compliant, an activity that has been started in 2013 already. And there's not a lot to do, but it is a very, very hard business to make them move to do the last necessary steps. And I would encourage anyone making business to really lobby their legislators in order to make changes that are required to allow to go fully digital. And if that is to be done on the digital identity side, then it's really urgent to undertake that, because digital identity is just the most basic infrastructure for digital exchange.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Oswald and Hans. Let me also add the comment. Actually, the second sort of about the question, the comment related to the government effort to move the digitization is quite important. And the impact on the business, I would say, I mean, particularly the machine readable, I mean, we really need to make sure that the old government papers, information should be machine readable. And, you know, just not just a PDF, not just a picture, but everything needs to be digitally recognizable. But I'd like to comment one important issue, particularly when it comes to the international business or international activity, cross-border activity. There is always the area of need of translation. You know, the simply we need to make sure what A in, let's say, for example, Japanese one, a translation to English, maybe apple, but apple in English, I mean, normally indicates the same thing, but there could be slight difference in what people think in your mind, you know, could be difference. And particularly in the legal area, in the context, what is written in the common law, and also what is written in the continental law is not always the same. And these legal tradition needs to be clearly understood, otherwise the translation won't happen. I mean, or there will be the possibility of mistranslation. And so to make machine readable, we need to make an extra effort. And I think in this area, particularly the XBRL has made a lot of efforts, also the progress, in a sense that the particularly the accounting area or financial information, the gap is relatively small. So they made a huge effort and success to create a common taxonomy, so that the translation won't create a large difference. So when we move to the sort of a digitization and translation needs to take place, and there is area that still machine is quite dumb. They are stupid. So the human needs to translate what they can understand in the machine language is what we mean. Truly what we mean, and still we need some effort. That's actually exactly what is ABMF, ASEAN Plus Reborn the Market Forum, is doing. We've been publishing the Bond Market Guides for our member countries, and we always try to make sure what they mean is applicable equally or same thing or not. And this effort is quite important. So yes, things needs to be machine readable. Everything should be digitized. But unfortunately, there's still large room that the human needs to make a lot of effort. And particularly when it comes to the cross-border international transaction, those efforts would be necessary. That's my additional comment. Any other questions, comments?
I think while we're looking if there's more comments, I'll add one more comment to build on what you've said. One of the things we've also found is there's a lot of great trade agreements out there between different countries that say they're going to have MOUs and work between countries to try and digitize trade flows and specifically remove data, standardize on semantics to get to that machine learning state. What I have found, and maybe this is something we can all collectively work on, is while governments are quite familiar and aware with these agreements, a lot of businesses locally don't necessarily fully appreciate or understand the opportunity at hand. And so the more we can get some of those businesses involved to leverage those opportunities with government, the better.
Okay. Well, let me ask Hans and Oswald. In the previous working webinars, one of the kind of a challenge raised through the speakers was the how we can create most sort of a buy-in from non-financial institutions. I mean, the trade is really the one of the important area, you know, not only banks but industries themselves need to be involved. One of the challenge was the how we can create more sort of a voluntary acceptance of LEI, not the regulatory mandatory requirement. And do you have any good idea how we can push the implementation in the industry, even including the SMEs?
Well, Oswald, if you allow me, I'll take this question. And, you know, it's about digital density. There is, at the moment, not enough reason to really go digital, or there has not been enough reason to go digital. COVID-19 has changed this and accelerated the path to digitalization a lot. Now, people need to understand what they're investing in, and that's probably the hardest part. Once people understand the necessity to invest in digital, a lot more people will do it. And that means the digital density of trade activities in the world will intensify. And then at some point in time, a situation will come where you cannot really easily participate in trade if you have not invested in digitalization. For instance, if you have failed to adopt a digital identity, and now the bank come into play, or banks come into play to help non-financial institutions to adopt this. And now I go back to one of my slides where I put Commerzbank in the position of a verifiable lie issuer. I think that's a service that we could offer to our customers. So the customers are being equipped with digital identities that they can use for their digital interactions. Now, long speech, back to the beginning, more investments need to happen into digitalization, into digital exchange, in order to get rid of paper in the course of the next 5 years. And the banks could probably help by being the lie issuers for SMEs. And if lots of banks do that, then the path to digitalization will shorten.
Yeah, thank you. I completely agree, actually. I mean, the banks are spending millions of dollars for onboarding and ongoing customer due diligence. they should get some fees, or at least they should maximize the their sort of cost to get some benefits.
That's the flip side of the coin. We are really spending enormous funds on KYC. If that is being eased, and if KYC becomes a lot less expensive, then we have also benefits from that. And we close the trade finance gap for especially SMEs.
And I think there's a question to Oswald. So the role of WTO in terms of the digitization and the kind of a trade agreement in terms of digitization. Do you have any comments, Oswald?
Yeah, I don't want to speak on their behalf, but what I would do is I would agree with that sentiment and statement. I do think there's a part to play. And I do think what you would see is people like Emmanuel Garnier from the World Trade Organization being one of the inspirational leaders really in this space, doing quite a few things. Firstly, is on the DSI board and giving us a lot of guidance and advice just on the standard side. But also what you would have seen the WTO and Emmanuel and them do is do a lot of public events to try and educate people on how to leverage this. Now, on the trade agreement side, I always would say that there's more that we can do. But let me not get into too much trouble. Last comment on everything that Hans also just said is, I also bring it back to when I talk to a lot of businesses, they aren't necessarily always also familiar with the LEI. And so I think there's a big opportunity for all of us to help spread the word that there is actually a solution that's going to help reduce complexity, cost, and risk internally for organizations, and I think that we'll see them embrace it a lot quicker.
And probably that relates to the last question that, you know, whether ICCC made any research on LEI, you know, the potential benefits in the trade.
Oh, I love this question. So the irony in that, so long story short, the way I look at the world is, and I know we're out of time, but what I will say is when we look at it from a prioritization perspective, based on the research that we're doing, there's two dimensions. The first is we're looking at it from a carrier, importer, exporter, and then bank perspective. So the financial services side is at the end of our process because the BIC is already there and there's quite a few things there that you can optimize and you need to optimize, but there's a lot of space, especially when it comes to importers and exporters, especially when you think about retail and pharmaceuticals. So from a volumes perspective, the easier industry for us to probably convert would be the commodity side. Supply chains are simpler. There's a lot more money, to be quite frank and honest with you. And there's a few trade routes that are very strategic in the commodity sector. But when it comes to volume of LEIs, not value of trade, when it comes to volumes, that's retail. And the challenge that we have with retail, I could spend an hour on, but what I will say is low margin, high complexity supply chains is definitely an area where I do believe, and I like how what Hans also said, where the banks can potentially come and play a part. I do believe that that's the space where we need to really see how we help.
Hans, do you have any additional comment?
No, it's...
It's okay.
It's fine. It's perfect.
Okay, but, thanks.
Oswald said, and especially love him emphasizing the role of the banks again.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. Well, I'm conscious of the time, so I'd like to close the today's webinar. Well, Hans and Oswald kindly agreed to join the final webinar, the panel session. So if you have further questions to those two speakers, please join the panel session. We should have enough time to discuss various issues, not just the trade. But of course, we can discuss those issues as well. So thank you so much, Hans, Oswald, for your kind participation. And for participants, thank you so much for your kind participation. So the next ADI webinar will be the 9th July, and we will discuss the introduction of ADI in ASEAN. We will have a speaker from the Bank Negara Malaysia. Also, Malaysia also the leading country to implement ADI. And finally, I will explain the ADB's proposal, how we can implement ADI through the standardization. So thank you so much for your kind participation, and see you at the next webinar. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.